So it's an honor and privilege to have amongst us Professor Yogesh Snehi, who has come all the way from Delhi, and he's going to talk on his research work. And I was totally, you know, taken aback when I happened to see the title of the talk. So, in the memory of a peer, that means, you know, this city, Hyderabad, has so many shrines. There is always this rich tradition of Sufis that this city has. And a very, very, you know, strong connection, or you can call it like an interlude, to a very tiny place called Manakpur. And that is the research that Professor Yogesh has done. So he's going to talk about his research, and he's also going to share some of the very fine nuances of that shrine and darga. And we will also take a lot of other things. So before I invite Professor Yogesh, let me take this privilege of introducing you to Professor Yogesh. Professor Yogesh Snehi teaches at the History Department at the School of Liberal Studies, Ambedkar University, Delhi. And he was previously associated with the Indian Institute of Advanced Study, Shimla. And he has done major teaching and research interests focusing on Punjab and the popular religion and its practice. And through Tasveer Ghar Fellowship, that was between 2010 and 2011, he created a digital repository of images for the HealthCon image and multimedia database of Heidelberg University. And this repository has more than 500 images, ranging from postcard size and pocket size prints, CD, DVD and book covers, posters, large flex banners, and Photoshop collage. And there are also digital photographs, etc. They are all can be found at the website, which we will share it with you. And Snehi has recently also published a monograph specializing popular Sufi shrine in Punjab, Dreams, Memories, Territoriality, 2019, London, that is by Rollage. And then he also uses this other audiovisual collection to situate saint veneration practices in the partition of India, particularly Punjab. So this audiovisual collection captures the form and content of the worship, rituals, practices at Sufi saint shrines, which present an enchanted world of non-Muslim veneration of Sufi saint in contemporary East Punjab. So there is also a takeaway material which we will pass on to you. It's a small leaflet about the book that he published. And so without further ado, please help me and join me in welcoming Professor Yogesh Snehi at Lamakaan.
Over to you. Thank you very much, Naeem, for your kind introduction, and I hope I'll be able to do justice with the kind of audience that is there today. Academicians do love to talk, but they are more attuned to talk in closets of academic environment, and it's not so easy for academics to communicate in an environment like this, which is like a public forum, and where you have a diverse range of people coming and both listening and interacting. So I also see it as a challenge, a learning experience in that way, and I hope I'll be able to do justice to that also. Punjab as a province, for many of you might be aware of, was one of the largest provinces to be partitioned in 1947. And as compared to Bengal, this was also the most bloodiest of partitions. Which led to killing of several thousands of people, and also one of the biggest migrations in human history. This migration meant a complete transformation of what we now know as the Western and the Eastern Punjab. So the West Punjab became predominantly Muslim thereafter, and the East Punjab, as we know, became predominantly Sikh and Hindu. But if you look at the landscape of this partitioned Punjab, the landscape of partitioned Punjab continues to be very, very rich and diverse and complicated, therefore. Because despite the fact that huge migrations took place from east to west of Punjab, the material edifices of a set of shrines that I will be talking about today continue to remain and therefore also complicate the space post-partition. So you do have, as you would go in Punjab, you would hardly find Muslim, Punjabi Muslims there now, except for Malerkotla, except for a place that I'll be talking about in Ropar. But then you have a large number of shrines, Sufi shrines, Sufi Saint Mystic shrines. And Sufi Saint Mystic shrines are one of very important structural edifices post-partition, because unlike mosques on this side of the Punjab or temples and gurdwaras on the other side of the Punjab, Sufi shrines in terms of their usage, in terms of their reutilization post-partition, were not neither demolished nor put to reuse. So we know in Pakistan several temples are today used as storehouses. We know of gurdwaras which are now mosques. We know in this part of Punjab several mosques which are temples or gurdwaras. So there is some peculiarity to Sufi shrines, say Sufi Saint Mystic shrines, that continue to survive in some or other way in the Indian side of the Punjab, despite the fact that you don't have the caretakers who were associated with these shrines in the pre-partition context. So that made for me an interesting research area, an interesting aspect to explore, particularly during the time when I got recruited in a college in Amritsar. I came across this new set of shrines which has started suddenly, because I joined there in 2005 and it was just the beginning of the 21st century. I started coming across a new set of several new shrines in and around Amritsar, in Batala, at Mahu, in southern Punjab near my hometown also. I started seeing mushrooming of these new set of Sufi shrines. So this once again became a quite an important ambition for me to look at to these in this emerging phenomena where you see this new set of Sufi shrines coming in a space, once again as I'm emphasizing, where you don't find Muslim population. So what intrigued me therefore to look at the histories of particularly the popular shrines, and you would see that I'm not talking about shrines which survived, and we know some of the shrines did survive post-partition, survive in the sense that they didn't bear the brunt of partition as much. But I predominantly talk about such shrines which did suffer in some ways. There was a break in ritual practice, and it is slowly, gradually that the shrine actually achieves the ritual practice, reinstates the ritual practice that was lost long ago. So I want to say 2-3 things. One important thing that I want to say is that in order to understand what Sufism is in Punjab or Sufi Saint practice is in Punjab, we need to understand that there is a large spectacle of popular practices in Punjab, which ranges from deras, which ranges to from Sufi shrines to small kind of street shrines or village small little shrines. So shrine dedicated to Gugga, shrines dedicated to some popular piece or otherwise, small and big. So you do have a very different kind of veneration practices. Now, irrespective of what we call the large communal identities that we are aware of, Hindu, Muslim, Sikh predominantly in Punjab's case. So you do have a vibrant space which was open to conversations of a different kind, where associations are of very different kind. And in these very spaces, and because I'm talking about Sufi shrines, we do also have shrines dedicated to Sufi Saint mystics like Sakhi Sarwar, like Haider Sheikh. Sakhi Sarwar's shrine is in Dera Ghazi Khan in Pakistan, or Haider Sheikh, whose parent shrine is in Malerkotla, and small shrines which are called memorial shrines. I call them as memorial shrines. Situated in the urban and rural landscape of Punjab, which were never actually Muslim-owned shrines. So that's an interesting aspect, because it's not just about Hindus and Sikhs going to Sufi shrines. It's not an aspect I'm exploring solely, because Hindus and Muslims going to Sufi shrine is a practice which is prevalent in all parts of India. Now we know it. But I'm also talking about shrines in this particular book, which Naeem was also referring to, of shrines which were never Muslim governed or taken care of by Muslims. So Muslim sajada nishins were not heard of in these shrines. These are owned by Khatris, these are owned by Agarwal Samaj, these are owned by communities which we don't, at least dominantly don't associate with Sufi saint practices of other kind. Visitation is one aspect. You go, you visit, you offer dua, you seek blessings or otherwise. But to be part of the conduct of the ritual practice, to be the caretaker of a shrine was something which was new to me, because you would find several works of Sufi saint visitation, but not as many on how shrine practices are vibrantly also associated with identities other than Muslims. So that became actually even more important exploration during my field surveys that I conducted from 2005 onwards. So it almost like 15 years of these field surveys. So what I will try to do therefore is to begin by showing a video to you. Now this video, I want to play actually Amritsar video. This video is I'm not a trained photographer or a videographer, so you would please apologize. I apologize for the poor quality of the visual display. This is actually a memorial urs. I hope most of you know what an urs is. Urs is a celebration of, it's a death anniversary of a Sufi saint. And this urs is celebrated in Amritsar at a place which is like less than 100 meters from Golden Temple. So for me and many of us who associate Amritsar as a city with Sikh center of veneration, perhaps would never even believe or imagine that there continued, even before actually Amritsar came into being during the fourth Sikh Guru, there were Sufi saint shrines in Amritsar. We have records of Sufi saint mystic shrines even before that. So Amritsar had a longer tradition also, engagement with Sufi saint practices. And what I am trying to show you here is an urs celebrated. And it doesn't, it's not of a shrine, once again. It's an urs celebration. You would see qawwal singing there. It's at a place close, less than 100 meters from Golden Temple. And just notice, because you would not, this is an urs where you don't find Muslims. It's an urs where you would find people singing or performing qawwali who are Muslims, who are Darbari qawwals from Kaliyar Sharif. But among the audience, there is no Muslim. So therefore, that becomes an interesting entry point into how do you understand a place, space, and how do you also understand certain forms of commemoration, memorialization. And what is being remembered here particularly, we need to understand, there were two important Sufi mystic shrines from medieval India would be remembered in this particular practice. One is Sakhi Sar, which I just referred to, and the second is Baba Farid. So Baba Farid, you know, is one of the Punjab's known Sufi saint mystic who finds an important place also within the Sikhism. So these are the two most important Sufi saints besides the third, who is Sabir Pak from Kaliyar Sharif, who is also remembered, memorialized in this particular small video clip. Can we play that video clip?
देखिए सामाई, ये सामने से पुराने का मामला खत्म कर दे, इस साइड में आ जाओ पुलिस वाले। इस
Thank you.
फकीर की सूरत
फिर मेरा फकीर की सूरत
बदले शायर कदीर की सूरत यहाँ कहीं जहाँ कहीं मेरे कदमों में लफ्ज़िश आई
जहाँ कहीं मेरे कदमों में लफ्ज़िश आई
मेरे निसार वही आस आती
Now there are two, three things that you might have witnessed in this small presentation, video presentation. There were the set of three people who were sitting towards the left, who one of whom came later. These are actually sajada nishins from nearby shrines. So one of them who organizes, one who organizes this Urs celebrations. And another one had come from, the one who arrived actually towards the end was Baba Meshi Shah, who had come from the nearby shrine in Batala. It's a very important town. And the third I was actually was Sufi Rashid Mia from Delhi. So you would see there seems to be some set of network, some set of connectivity. And this is a very recent video. I think I recorded it in somewhere in 2007 or 8. So this is a very recent recording. So this Sufi saint veneration practices, particularly in the 21st century, it's an important thing that I wanted to underline. There seems to be a resurgence. There seems to be a renewed interest. In fact, Amritsar itself has a Sufi Samvad Sanstha, wherein actually this particular festival is organized by Anjuman Gulame Chishtiya Sabriya, whose president when I recorded this was a Jatsik, Kittu Grewal. And as you would see, there was a mix of visitors into in this Urs, and I actually did some survey to find out what is the nature of people who come here from at this particular Urs. There are private shrines of Dalits. If the Valmiki is at Lahori Gate, you have a shrine dedicated to Baba Farid there. So you have incoming Dalits community who comes to venerate this particular Urs. And there are also Urs celebrated in several parts of the walled city of Amritsar. So this is not the only one. Besides that, you had local Lalas of city of Amritsar, local businessmen, and also the upper caste among Hindus who were part of this particular celebration. So this kind of milieu is an important thing that we need to understand when we are talking about Sufi Zen practices, particularly in the zone that I am talking about. So now, but this is a very terrible process. Terrible in the sense it's a very slow, gradual process. And you know, post-partition also, Punjab has had different phases of violence also. You need to realize that also. Right from the Suba movement, because this led to emergence of a linguistic debate, which led to sense of, I would not say physical violence, but definitely strains of relationship between the Hindus and the Sikhs over question of language. Followed by that, you had from the 70s onwards, at least two decades of the period of what some people may call the Khalistani movement, some others may call the period of the militancy, which was also a very difficult time, by the way, because during the period of militancy, particularly in the case of Sufi shrines, I'll show you the example that I'll share with you, did suffer a lot because they were targeted. They were targeted because a large number of Sikhs used to go to Sufi Zen mystic shrines, and they were looked upon as threat. And this is not, by the way, not for the first time that Sufi Zen mystic shrines were looked upon as threat. In the early 20th century also, Singh Sabha reformers were dissuading Sikhs from going to the Sufi Zen mystic shrine because they used to go in large numbers. And by the way, they were not the only one. The Hindus, among the Hindus, there was a well-established practice to go to Sufi Zen mystic shrines. The Sanatan Dharma and Arya Samaj movement similarly dissuaded the Hindus to go to Sufi Zen mystic shrines. But the interesting part is actually there were reform movements among the Muslims also. I can refer to some of them, MDA movements, say for instance, small Anjumans actually, which were quite active in Amritsar and other areas. They also dissuaded the Muslims to go to Sufi Zen mystic shrines. I argue, because the early 20th century is a period when a lot of identity movements have started emerging. There was an emphasis on identity based on language, identity based on certain notions of religion, and popular shrines particularly were always looked upon as threat to imagination of these singular form of identities. So this is a long therefore struggle, particularly in the case of Sufi mystic shrines, post-partition when you don't have Muslim caretakers, this becomes an even more bigger problem. So what we will see that slowly and gradually you set to have new set of caretakers coming in who started occupying these shrines in places where there were small Muslim communities. And remember, by the way, only Muslim community, as I said, remained particularly among the upper class and castes among the Muslims were in Malerkotla, where you had Jat Muslims, you had other Muslims. But then in other parts like Ropar, you had lower caste among Muslims who were left behind. So they came forward to take over some of these abandoned shrines when Sajada Nishins left to Pakistan. In other cases, there were local communities. There were people who were migrating from Pakistan actually, who had a background of visitation to big shrines in Pakistan, at Pakpatan or in Lahore. They were the ones who came forward also to take up some of these shrines, reinvent some of these shrines also. So it's a slow, gradual process, and a process which lingers on varyingly from 10 years to sometimes in the case of the shrine in Manakpur Sharif, it actually becomes active only in the mid-90s. So some of these shrines, the process actually lingers on for a very long period of time. So this is something that becomes an important scenario. But what remains important is that in the early 21st century, you would not find a Sufi shrine in Punjab today which doesn't function, which is not alive. So most Sufi shrines are alive. And in this case, as you would have seen, the qawwals were singing predominantly in Urdu or Hindustani. But in several other shrines in Punjab, Punjabi kawals sing predominantly, you know, because this shrine has a very strong relationship with Kaliyar Sharif, which is in Western UP. So kawals from Kaliyar Sharif also come there. Kaliyar Sharif also has a very interesting relationship with Punjab, because Sabir Pak was the nephew of Baba Farid. So the strong familial relationship with Sabir Pak and shrine in Uttar Pradesh continues to remain important. And these links are actually inscribed to reinstate some of these practices. And you would find particularly in the Maja area, particularly, and Malwa area, not so much in Duaba, network of shrines which are associated with the Chishti Sabri tradition. So these are interesting things which have started happening, and Urs celebration and qawwali performance becomes one of the most fundamental ways in which the ritual practice at many of these shrines would start getting reinstated. Let me take you to certain slides. These are slides from Manakpur Sharif. Now Manakpur Sharif has an interesting association with also Hyderabad, and therefore I thought let me talk about Manakpur Sharif in particular. Manakpur Sharif, Sufi saint mystic was Hafiz Musa. He is a saint from the colonial period of India. He died somewhere towards the latter part of the 19th century. I don't exactly remember his date of death, but I think in 50s and 60s, 1850s, 60s that he dies. And a shrine is constructed over his burial, which is known as Manakpur, which is in village of Manakpur, but place is known as Manakpur Sharif. But one of his most important disciple actually was from Hyderabad, Shah Khamosh. So as I will take you through slides, my effort is not to talk as much on Shah Khamosh, because my work is not on Sufi saint mystics of Hyderabad as much, but I will take you through a certain set of shrines and also visuals which will give you a glimpse of an idea of how these slowly and gradually these practices were reinstated. Now what is important also in the case of this particular shrine, because as I said, many of the sajada nishins or caretakers or descendants of Sufi saint mystics had left for Pakistan in many cases, at least in the case of such big shrines, because this is a very big shrine. It was also endowed by huge land, which was, remember, either kind of occupied by incoming refugees from Pakistan, or in several cases legally occupied or illegally even occupied. This was also a shrine. So in 1964, when Wakf Board came into being, at least the land, the agricultural land associated with the shrine was transferred to the Central Wakf Board. It is only later that Punjab Wakf Board comes into being, so the land is thereafter transferred to Punjab Wakf Board. But shrine continues to remain with a local managing committee. There is a local managing committee known as Ropar District Roza Sharif Welfare Committee, which manages this shrine, which is Muslim Welfare Committee, constituted predominantly of Muslims, but also people from locals, from the villages, who also come forward. So they have Jat Sikhs, they have people working in government institutions. They in fact also invite local MLAs and MPs in their function, and as you would see in some of these slides also. So reinstating of ritual practices therefore involves in this case not necessarily the only scenario was not the direct intervention of the locals, but many of the, because the connection was completely lost. You didn't know anything about the shrine's past. The village, which was predominantly Muslim dominated village, was completely emptied of Muslim population. The new people who came in were all non-Muslims. Only village Muslim community which were living in nearby places like Majri, they were all Dalit Muslims. So these were some important complexities in the case of this particular shrine. So in and as you would see, I'll show some pictures from around the partition, the desolate shrine, as you would see. So it is the sajada nishins of Shah Khamosh from Hyderabad who start visiting this particular shrine because of their very long association, Shah Khamosh being the important disciple of Hafiz Musa. They also start playing a very important role. So for instance, 7 days in a year, they would stay here, particularly around the Urs celebration, and try to reinstate ritual practice. But everyday affairs would obviously have to be maintained by somebody from the area. But that too was a huge challenge because Punjab was passing through a very terrible phase. And as I underlined, during the phase of the 70s, 80s and the 90s, there was a rise of militancy. And during the rise of this militancy, particularly during the 80s, bombs were thrown on the shrine, the walls were destroyed. We come across one of the caretakers in the nearby shrine, Majri, who was shot dead. We also know some of the langri, means the helpers, who were, remember, langris and the helpers usually came from Dalit communities. In this case, they were Mazhabi Sikhs. Mazhabi Sikhs are lower caste among the Sikhs. They were also killed, few of them were also killed. So shrine was passing through a very terrible phase. None of them would, not many people would agree to even stay there because it was a threat on life. So targeting of these kind of shrines, this set of shrines, was an interesting phenomenon during the phase of the militancy. And by the way, this is not the only case. In Malwa region of Punjab also, which is the southern part of Punjab, I did come across case studies where the Khatri caretakers of a Sakhi Sarvar shrine was shot dead. Once again in the same period, in the 80s itself. So reinstating of practice at popular Sufi shrines in Punjab was not so easy as an enterprise. It was not just about a question of people visiting the place, which continued to come in large numbers, which continued to keep visiting the spaces. But the question was also to reinstate practice, reinstate Urs celebration, reinstate a long tradition that the shrines had with its past or otherwise. Can we go to the next slide? So in this case, as you would see, the Manakpur, this is immediately after partition. Manakpur also experienced a lot of partition violence. These are not areas which are close to the border. Remember, Ropar is close to Chandigarh. So it's actually on the edge of Haryana in some ways. After that, you come enter into Ambala. So these were areas where some of the worst riots would also take place because of the outgoing Muslim population. So this also shrine became, with this village particularly, also became center of this violence. And I come to know these through narratives of the existing Muslim population there. And as I said, the newcoming population was completely non-Muslim. The only small communities of Muslim which lived were in Majri, small areas around, and they all were from lower caste among the Muslim community. Next slide, please. This is the main shrine actually. This is the entrance to that same shrine. And this once again around from the immediately after partition. So this would be a long drawn process, reinstating of this practice. Can we go to the next slide, please? Now, as I said, Hyderabad plays a very important role in reinstating of some of these practices. You see this person in the center is Sayyid Nizamuddin Akbar Husseini. He is the Sadaja Nishin of Dargah Shah Khamosh in Hyderabad. He, with his son, start visiting Manakpur Sharif on a regular basis every year and would stay for a week or otherwise, or alternative years would come back and try to reinstate practice in Manakpur Sharif. And the background is actually of Shah Khamosh Shrine. So I took this picture from Manakpur Sharif Shrine Facebook page. So this is not mine picture. The earlier ones were also not mine picture. Mine pictures will follow. So this becomes an important can we move on to the next slide? Once again, Sayyid Nizamuddin Akbar. Next slide, please. Now, to and fro also takes place. The person that you see with the Sajana machine of Shah Khamosh in the center is actually on the left is Mendiasan, Baba Mendiasan. Baba Mendiasan actually was very instrumental in mediating several of these ritual practices. He used to live in Manjari. He was associated with a different Sufi order, so therefore he didn't find what called permanent place into Manakpur Sharif, but he dedicated a lot of time, particularly at the time when nobody would dare to enter Manakpur Sharif in the 80s, in the late 70s, 80s and the early 90s. So this person, Mendi Hassan, who is in red clothes, long gown and wearing a red shawl, this is Mendi Hassan. He is visiting actually Hyderabad. So this is actually Shah Khamosh Shrine. He's come to Hyderabad. Next slide, please. And then visits of the Sadar Nishin of Hyderabad to Manakpur. So at the background you see Manakpur Sharif, and this is Sayyid Nizamuddin Akbar Husseini. and his son, who was visiting. This photograph was undated, so we don't know when was it clicked, but must have been 20, 30 years ago. Next slide, please. So this is how actually the shrine looks today. For the first time that the shrine, extensive repairs to the shrine took place, and it was painted, nicely painted, as you see now. This was done in year 2010. So just imagine, for a period from 1947 to the year 2010, no major repairs took place at the shrine. The ritual practice did start. As I said, it's not that Urs was abandoned, but visitation to the shrine was not regular. There would not be people who would always be there at shrine, particularly in the 70s, 80s and the early 90s. But here the shrine looks almost brand new, right? Completely painted, repaired. So, and this actually is from Urs celebration, a day before the Urs celebration in 2010, when I visited the shrine complex. Next slide, please. Now, shrine today does not necessarily just has Hafiz Musa shrine complex, but at the same time maintains several other practices. So you have a Baba Farid Vridh Ashram, old age home, also which is run from the Manakpur Sharif shrine, because it's a very large shrine actually. And you have in the shrine complex two major mosques, one of which was actually got constructed by Shah Khamosh himself. I don't have the picture of that in these slides, but Shah Khamosh got constructed one of the mosques actually in this. So Vridh Ashram or old age home is run from there. Next slide, please. And this is a gateway, a huge gateway. This shrine, by the way, just remember that it is from the late 19th century. So it's not a very old shrine. It's not more than one and a half century old. It's just a 1.5 century old. So these are pretty new shrines. Next slide, please. This is the entry gate to the walls of the shrine are painted with murals of stories here and there. And you would find some of the surviving murals also from the pre-partition times, which is on the gateway, not this one. And here in this case, you would see Gurdasman also situated along one of these murals. Musicians have played, musical performances have played a very major role in reinstating practices at Sufi Saint Mystic shrines. And several popular musicians of Punjab, Laltu was just now referring to Nooran sisters, the female singers, or Gurdasman, Harbhajan Man, there's several, what was his name, Miss Agrawal, I've forgotten his name. All of them are associated with one or other Sufi shrine. So this is intermingling, the association of Sufi shrines with music practice is also quite intrinsic, particularly in the area which which we call the Dwaba area. Nakhodar is one of the places where several of the musicians got associated with the Sufi shrines and found successful career. So this association is very interesting. With Chishti Sabri, Kadri shrines, and the budding musicians. Next, please. And I see this association also in terms of, Punjab was left bare of musicians. This is a small, tiny part of Punjab which had at least three to four musical gharanas. Patiala gharana, Shyam Chaurasi gharana, I'm forgetting one more. So at least three major gharanas were from this part, which all the musicians went to Pakistan. So it was left bare. So musicians getting associated with shrine and practices becoming a means through which they were finding careers, successful careers in the life, were also interlinked. So in a way, shrines becoming alive brought alive a lot of things in terms of ritual practice. And Punjab has also produced, one of the finest of qawwali singers. We know from close by in Batala, we had Vadadi brothers and several others actually who have made their careers out of singing Sufi, singing qawwalis and compositions of some of the most important of Sufi writers like Bulle Shah and others. And this is from 2010. As I said, Urs celebration had started right after partition, but they had not become too big, they had not become major. It is only around the beginning of the 21st century that they started finding a lot of visuality. They started finding a lot of acceptability also around into the. So in 2010, when I visited, the shrine was freshly painted for the first time. Next, please. And so along with that, some set of along with Urs, along with qawwali, along with that, as you see in the next visuals, re-establishment of langar, which are very intrinsic to Sufi Saint Mystic Shrine once again, as it is to Sikh Gurdwaras in all across India. Establishment langar is also very important. In fact, I came across this set of shrines in the Malwa region, where shrine complex was tiny, but langar khana was like 10-15 times bigger than the shrine space. So the number of people who visit to that shrine is far bigger than the shrine can accommodate. So langar khanas are very huge. So establishment of therefore langar khanas, huge langar khanas, are also one important process of reinstating some of these practices, besides some of the schedules which will now be drawn upon, which are more formal schedules, I would say, the more formal way of reinstating practice, offering namaz, offering ritual practices of preparing jhanda, and then taking a procession to the shrine, offerings or otherwise, they become part. So now they have become quite serialized, quite ritualized in a more formal sense. Next slide, please. This is Baba Mendiasan. He is tying chanda here. Chanda means flag, flag which is usually a symbol of sovereignty, symbol of veneration or otherwise. Next, please. And then qawwali though is one of the most important intrinsic part, but popular music performances also continue to be a very important process. So as you would see in brackets everywhere in the posters, for those who could read Punjabi, but I have translated it to some places, there will always be a mention of mela. So it's not just a formal urs where the death anniversary of the saint would also be, but it is also a popular mela. It's a popular space of, I would not want to use term entertainment which some scholars use, but also visitation, I would say, a popular place of visitation. So it becomes almost a mela, mela where you would find everyday needs of many of them rural melas, rural fairs, where you would find all kinds of produce available. You would also find pictures of Sufi saint mystics or their shrines in circulation, which are on sale. All kinds of material is available at these melas, and entertainment also becomes. As I said, shrines were very important places where these new budding musicians performed. And as you would see, some of them performances by the budding musicians also takes place at Manakpur, besides the formal qawwalis. Qawwalis are one part of the entire ritual practice, but budding musicians also come there. Besides, as you see, among the invitees, there are MPs, there are MLAs, there are cabinet ministers or otherwise. So finding an acceptability in the space is also a very important process in which shrine practices find a place. Next slide, please. So besides Manakpur, as I said, there are nearby shrines of the Chishti Sabaris. Majri is one of the place where you will find it. Tarapur Sharif is yet another place. All nearby places in and part across this area, where similarly new set of urs start during this period of time. Next piece. And all dedicated to, as you could see, the picture above there of Baba Lakhdata, the one above was of Baba Lakhdata, and Langar Khana. Langar Khana, as I said, Langar becomes also a very important practice. Yes. Now, interestingly, and 2-3 years ago, I visited Hampi to give a lecture at Kannada University there, and there came an interesting person who actually did a Sufi pravachan there, which I had heard for the first time. And in his presentation, was very powerful presentation. He gave a presentation in Dakini. I think he is from this area. He's from somewhere here in nearby Hyderabad. But one of the interesting component of the conversation there was how systematically, slowly and gradually competitions of wrestling have stopped being organized in Sufi saint shrines in this part of India, the Deccan and the south. On the contrary, actually, in Punjab, this wrestling competitions have started yet again. And I think wrestling competitions have a very interesting, have a very crucial substance to what a Sufi shrine resembles. And as you see, can you take the next slide? He is, ironically, he is once again part of the managing committee of Manakpur Sharif. Wrestling is not just about competition. It's among one of the few sports. And as you would see, as I'm already emphasizing, this sport is open to everyone. So you see Muslims coming here, you see Hindus coming here, you see also Sikhs coming here, participating in the wrestling competition, also as viewers and otherwise. And wrestling, by the way, had a very long tradition in Punjab. We have produced some of the best of wrestlers from Rustam, from several of those important wrestlers came from Punjab, either Muslim or non-Muslim. But wrestling is also a very different kind of conversation, a bodily conversation, which in a way also does away with the taboos of touch, the taboos of touch with the other. So I find this sport very fascinating, despite the fact that this sport is predominantly controlled by and performed by males. But nevertheless, there is a very strong, interesting process into what wrestling does. Ek toh mitti ke andar this is predominantly done in mud, so this is a different form of wrestling altogether. But then bodies actually intersect with each other. So what wrestling does therefore is what actually Sufi shrine does. There is an incoming flow of a diverse nature of pilgrims, diverse nature of people, and diverse nature of ethnicities which mingle into the celebration of the Urs. So performance of kushti therefore becomes a very important process. And by the way, this is not just a phenomena here. At most important Sufi Saint mystic shrines in Punjab, you would find wrestling. You would find wrestling. And wrestling also similarly, as I said, become an important component of the how ritual practice, how shrines will become alive. Next slide, please. Lot of material on sale, as you would see in some of these images, as you would see here, this one behind actually, some of the popular Sufi Saint mystics of Punjab are represented, from Baba Farid, some from Delhi also, Nizamuddin Aulia. And they are also in circulation. So there continues to be networking of several set of these shrines, ranging from Rajasthan, Ajmer Sharif, or Western UP, Kaliyar, or in Panipat, or in Delhi, and also of places in Pakistan. So you will not access those places as much. But that does not mean that those Sufi Saint mystics would not be represented in these images. So these images become powerful medium through which circulation of this kind of connections to the past also takes place. So Baba Farid would also be there in these shrines, and all particularly Chishti Sufi mystic saints predominantly were remain in circulation. I wish I had this image. I have one, but I am not in the slide. Next, please. And also a wide range of DVDs and CDs, which are recordings of qawwalis, both studio performances or live performances of qawwals from large parts of India and Pakistan. So qawwals from UP, qawwals from Delhi, Punjabi qawwals from Malerkotla and elsewhere in Amritsar in Punjab, qawwals from Pakistan, qawwals from Rajasthan. So you would find a huge range of material on sale. Some of these were also performances actually, studio performances of popular narratives around like Baba Lakhdata, Sakhi Sarwar. So there will be theatre, popular performances, they're serials, they're literally serials, kind of TV, not obviously shown on TV, but they're serials on lives of some of these Sufi Saint mystics. So all this kind of stuff is also in circulation at several of these melas, Urs celebrations. Next slide, please. Now, one of the interesting part is if some of you have gone to Delhi, I'm not sure of Hyderabad, but in Delhi you can't go inside the sanctum of Nizamuddin Aulia. Only men can go there, women can't go there. But that's not the case with Punjab. In Punjab, women can easily go into the sanctum of Sufi Saint mystic shrine. There are no taboos around women visitation to Sufi Saint mystic shrines. So as you would see, this is actually the grave of Hafiz Musa. And women so close to the shrine offering and offering dua and offering other things is very much possible. Next slide, please. And also diverse nature of people. As I already said, in this image you can see a diverse set of pilgrims visiting and performing rituals altogether. They are offering dua in together in some way. There is no separation as you would see emerging here. And by the way, this is not the only shrine, set of shrines where you see it. Even typically in a Gurdwara also, if you go and visit a Gurdwara in India, any part of India, you would not find people discriminating on the basis of preconceived religious identities. Everyone will be open to come and visit these places, barring performances of some set of rituals like covering of the head or otherwise, you have to follow certain disciplines, but otherwise you would not be disallowed. But in this case, even women are allowed right in between, because women in Gurdwaras otherwise are not allowed into the sanctum so close. But in Sufis and mystic shrines of Punjab, women are not prohibited. Next, please. Now, this particular mosque was in possession of a Jat Sikh family in Manakpur for a long period of time. And it is only last year in December that he formally handed it over to the shrine. And he used to use it for storage purposes. And I remember interviewing Mehndi Hassan in 2010, where he lamented that the Jat Sikh family should be giving away this shrine. Giving away this mosque to the shrine. But the family continued to use it for storage purposes. But last year in December, next slide please, it was formally handed over to the shrine committee. I took that picture in 2010. Perhaps it was painted then, as you would see, now it is no longer in that neat condition in 2019. So, what has happened actually is, if you try to record this, from the year 1947, a very slow, gradual process which picks up particularly during the period after the militancy weans away. After the militancy goes away, you see important component of and visually also, you see shrine emerges in the sphere of Sufi Saint veneration practice, particularly this also. Not that these connections had not been established. They have been emphasizing Sardar Nishins from Hyderabad continue to visit Manakpur Sharif for a long period of time. But the most important change which takes place in the shrine of Manakpur Sharif happens only after the militancy as a period wins away. A long period of peace and stability which Punjab received also gave an opportunity for some of these practices to come back. Next please. So that's how shrine looks in 2010. It's a large complex, as you would see. There are small graveyards here and there, and two of the biggest mosques, one of which you can see behind, and one of which actually is on the right side here, which was occupied by a Sikh family and then thereafter given in 2020. So, this is actually clicked from the above the darwaza, the Bulam darwaza, the main gateway I had shown to you. On the left, this corner on the left, the kushti competition and other things are organized. And outside of the shrine, outside of the main doorway, there is a huge tank, water tank, we use for ritual bathing and other purposes, performing wuzu or otherwise, which is not there in the picture, but yes, it's part of the shrine complex. Besides that, it has a large property which is part now under the management of the Wakf Board. Wakf Board in Punjab is largely a defunct body because you don't have Muslim population. So Wakf Board is just an income generation institution. So except from Malerkotla, where you do have Muslim population in the town and area, other places either the Wakf Board keep filing disputes in the courts, fighting disputes in the courts, or receiving incomes from here and there of property otherwise. But the most important part of, and remember, this continues to be a Wakf Board property formally. The shrine continues to be a Wakf Board property formally, but in practice, this is controlled by a local managing committee, which runs the institution and which also reinstate practices. So these connections, therefore, are far more informal in those ways, post-partition, which took place over a period of time. I think the slides end there. We can play these two set of videos. Okay, the Mehfil qawwali, and you would see within the posters also, now very regularly in 2019, this is the poster, the Sardar Nishin of Hyderabad on the one side and Ajmer Sharif's Sardar Nishin on the other side, and the managing committee of the Manakpur Sharif in the center. You would find them situated now very commonly. So these connects have almost come to full circle. They have become formally established otherwise. I think it ends here. Now, let me play quickly these two set of YouTube videos, one of which is when Mehndi Hassan formally enters into the shrine sacred space at the time of beginning of Urs. This is one set of video. You see a very small video. This is from 2017. He's Mehndi Hassan in between. One thing which I wanted to also underline here, now, since the new set of practices have started becoming more formal into the space, I also came across a huge sense of variation between the practices performed by the locals, the local committee there, and the rituals performed by the troop which comes from Hyderabad. And there's a very stark difference, and this has to be underlined also because Sufis and mystic shrines have a very local flavor. Everywhere in India you would go, you'd find a very local flavor to the Sufis and mystic shrines. But in this case, because these connects are so significant for also to claim the shrine post-partition, you would find, come across a very strange kind of differences between the way in which the locals perform certain rituals there, the local managing committee, and the rituals which are performed by the troop which comes from Hyderabad. Then among the people who perform, as I said, there are qawwals, there could be popular musicians or otherwise, but there are also traditional bards which also perform at some of these shrines. Usually they narrate the stories, life histories of Sufi Saint mystics. And these bardi communities also find these spaces quite significantly convenient to visit, because post-partition there is another transformation which takes place. Large number of Muslim bards leave to Pakistan. The ones which were left behind started singing predominantly at Gurdwara, because there were no other places left where they could go, where they could perform. Otherwise, bards as a community always used to perform poetry, life histories, ranging from different kinds of religious affiliation. So they would sing Hir Ranja, but at the same time they may also sing life of a Sikh guru, and they would also perform at Sufi Saint mystic shrines. But post-partition, what happened, that because many of these shrines had become defunct, at least for, as I said, ranging from a period of 10 years to in this case several decades, bards had no place to perform. So bardic communities also became predominantly performing at Gurdwaras. They started performing predominantly Gurdwaras. So there is a very different kind. The partition does a lot of things, therefore, and we need not look at partition just as migration of population. It's actually one of a historian from a university in US, Wazira Zamindar, calls it actually the long partition. So therefore, partition is a continuous process. It's not something which stops at one juncture. So how this continuation of the effects of partitions is something that you would always see. But re-emergence of the shrine kind of heal those wounds of partition. As you would see in this particular and these are bards performing. They are known locally as tadis, D-H-A-D-I-S, tadi. And these are said as ritually they perform at Gurdwara these days, and they would be seen predominantly holding a small drum instrument, one string instrument, and a sarangi. Usually these are the three set of things, and one would be the major singer, and the three would sing together. So all there would predominantly be three to four performers. So this is one of the yet another example. Please play the video.
Yeah, we are capable of being a good friend.
this was some local politician who was visiting the shrine of Manakpur Sharif, and he actually, his photograph was also there in the one of the posters. So, and you would see that large tank that I was referring to, it was in the background. So just outside of Manakpur gateway that you see this performance taking place. So therefore there are different nuances through which practice get reinstated. Coming alive of a Sufi shrines has given a given life to all kinds of other things. In my last chapter of the book, I call this process as an important ways in which the process of what we call the reconciliation around partition takes place. Because several scholars have argued that reconciliation has to be very formal, sometimes even state ordained, as we have seen in the case of South Africa or elsewhere. Reconciliation becomes a very formal form of state practice. But in several of these cases, I see the way the reconciliation of partition takes place through these informal ways of in which these shrine practices get instituted post-partition is a very vibrant process. It doesn't require necessarily a state institution's intervention to build these reconciliations. And I think that's, and therefore they become a very, these sites become some very interesting case study in the lives of such territories, such spaces post-partition. Sadly though, in theories around, in scholarship around reconciliation, and even the institutions of memorialization of partition, like we recently have seen a marvelous museum which has emerged at Amritsar, some of you might have visited or must visit actually, around partition. This is the first partition museum of India, which centers around commemorating, which centers around revisiting what partition was and what it did. So they make use of a large set of material both from Pakistan and India to situate partition. But in none of these narratives do you see the ordinary lives. How do they transform? And as you would see in much of the museums, now one of the rationale of that could be the availability of material or otherwise, because much of these are very elite narratives of important individuals, important personalities, of their lives, of their narratives, but it does not talk about ordinary lives. It doesn't talk about lives which were far more deeply affected and as compared to those lives which were not so badly affected. Because you need to see that partition as a process very badly affected the poor among the communities of Punjab. One of my research students who has worked on how partition affected the Dalits who migrated from here and there. These are communities which never owned land. All they owned were cattle, few cattle, and they used to perform as agricultural laborers on the fields of respective Jat, Muslim or Sikh families, landholding families. So when they partitioned, they were not allowed to take their livestock. So they virtually had nothing when they migrated. So these set of lives, these set of possibilities of migration of these kinds of communities, Bardic communities, which had nothing actually except for performance. So those narratives never find a place in partition histories. And therefore it becomes very essential as a process also to see some of these reinventions of Sufi shrine practices. What do they do to regions past and regions contemporary narratives? So I'll end there. If you have questions, I can take some questions. Thank you very much once again for giving this opportunity.
I have two questions. One is concerning what I noticed specifically in all the videos that you presented, the clear presence of money that was very prominent in most. Like, I understand why it's there because there is an underlying economic reason, but I would also like your comment on, is there an economic aspect to all of this coming alive? I mean, your comment on the fact, which has always disconcerted me personally, because to me, what Sufi teachings are, it's directly in contrast with what Sufism teaches. which is not to have so much money, but they feature very prominently in all of these videos.
Hmm.
So one, that is my first part of the question. Second, it was surprising to me when you mentioned that somewhere in Gurudwaras, women are not allowed in the sanctum. That is also, I have never come across, and would be very surprising to me to learn about that.
Yes.
Thank you.
Maybe I'll start with the second question, which is easier to answer. In the Golden Temple premises, the sanctum where the Guru Granth is kept, the Golden Temple, women were not allowed to perform service there. The reason for that was there were taboos around menstruation. And it is only last year, in fact early this year, that for the first time in history of the Gurdwara movement, after the 20th century, that women have been allowed to perform seva in the sanctum sanctorium. So there were taboos. Even in most important of the, what you call the reformist or enlightened religious traditions, taboos against women have been a huge problem, particularly around menstruation and other. So women have been historically considered impure in many, most religious traditions of India. So my response to that is that, in fact, there emerged an important movement among what we know as the Gora Sikhs in the US, who started demanding for the first time, and that is like 10-15 years ago, right to women to perform kirtan and seva in the sanctum of the Golden Temple. Remember, these ragi performances are always men dominated, we know it. The musicians are male, the performers are male predominantly, they're never allowed. And in fact, post-partition, we know pre-partition, Muslim bards used to perform at Golden Temple, we know it. Because the family descendants of Mardana, who was an important associate of Guru Nanak, who was a Muslim actually, he was a Muslim bard, continued to perform at Golden Temple historically all the time, until partition. So in 2005, around 2000, I think it was 2005, 2005 is an interesting year actually, around 2005, the last among the performing descendants, Pai Chand, visited from Lahore, Golden Temple, and asked for an opportunity to perform in Golden Temple. SGPC refused on the context that only Sikhs can perform there. So how partition has changed certain set of historical narratives is something that we don't see, we don't really figure out. It seems that partition was just about partitioning of population, partitioning of territories. But what partition has done is something far, far more terrible. On the question of circulation of money or otherwise, I had specifically forced myself not to delve on that particular aspect, because that is the most visible aspect. In fact, as you would see, Gurdwara reform movement, when it started in the 1920s, one of the significant aspect of Gurdwara reform movement was mismanagement of Sikh shrine spaces. How is money utilized? How it is used, how it is used for the welfare of the temple or the community or otherwise. So management has been one of the major concerns of many of the reformist movements of the 20th century. But to solely talk about, so display of money may not become a prominent practice in Gurdwaras today, but the Golak still remains there. So offering continues to be a significant way. How do you utilize that offering is a different scenario. But what it does otherwise, it removes money from the visual gaze of the ordinary individual. So it gets directly into the Golak and then gets utilized. But in this case, the money is also visually present. So it has not been curtailed, screened, because political economy is, there is an important aspect of political economy in sustenance of shrine practices. It's not, no shrine can function. Lamakaan wouldn't function without money, you see. So money is an important, performs a very important function in sustaining certain set of practices. So I purposefully didn't bring it. But yes, there is an important influence of donations. Several politicians also come to donate money. Local money is also collected. And you know how jagratas are organized in Punjab. You get to the household to collect money for performing jagratas. Similarly, in Sufi shrine, during the time of Urs, You cut slips and collect donations and money here and there. Most of the offerings that you see were going actually to the performers, as you would see. They were going either to... So you don't pay the performance money that you pay in Lamakaan to people who come and perform here. You see, so all the charhava goes there. All the offerings therefore go to the performers. So money therefore becomes an important way also to sustain some of these practices. Otherwise, you know, these big singers who have made lives from performing in Sufis and mystic shrines in Punjab, you would not imagine what they would have received from the shrine rather than what they have given to the shrine. Nakodar becomes a very big example, yes. Exactly. So there's a lot has gone into making their careers through performing here at Sufi and mystic shrines. And therefore, I purposefully don't want to bring money into, because there is more to it. That's all I want to say. There's more to it. Money is, of course, important. Nobody can deny the significance of money. But there's more to it also besides money.
Actually, when we see these practices, especially, you know, post 1950s especially, you know, in Tamil Nadu especially, what happened is that, you know, because of the lack of patronage, you know, patronage becomes an important part. Because of the lack of patronage and, you know, to an extent, the loss of power of aristocrats, to an extent, you know, it has reduced the, you know, the grandeur of much of the events. When you say that these events got reinstated post 1980s and 1990s, and you know, comparatively in other parts of the state and even in Hyderabad, you know, generally, when I speak with the qawwals, they say about the loss of patronage. And you know, as you said right now, you know, people provide that, I mean, people cover that to an extent. So how do you see the rise of these shrines and practices associated with it, and the reduction, I mean, reduction of patronage?
No, in this case, it's a reverse process. The patronage now becomes possible actually because the availability of platforms to perform have become even larger. So therefore, it's actually the reverse. So instead of the patronage getting reduced, which was true in the early decades post-partition, the patronage has become now a prominent feature. So they are able to generate money, they are able to, and therefore, as I said, the sheer fact of rise of so many musicians from Punjab post-partition is something as a case study to be looked at. What went to Pakistan, many of us who love Coke Studio or otherwise, we know it. All these gharanas went from Punjab, you see. Delhi gharana, Patiala gharana, Shamsharasi gharana, all these went from this part of Punjab to Pakistan. So, which took away a very vibrant tradition of performance of music. But in this scenario, and leaving a space for new budding, I would say, these musicians who rose from this space, and there are several of them. So new set of patrons actually therefore come into picture because of this coming of the new set of shrines. And this very strong association which I was underlining between these new musicians and Sufi and mystic shrines. That's what they are singing, that's what they are performing predominantly also in several of these melas. I can't hear you.
How does market play a role? Because, you know, in majority of the areas, you know, either it is print or otherwise, you know, after patronage, there is a transition period and there is market. You just spoke about how market, I mean, the budding musicians and other markets coordinate with these people. And you know, we have instance of folk studio bringing in local kapals. I mean, is there a strong presence of market in these?
See, there is a presence of market. I would say market of production, market of DVD and CD, and before that age, cassette production. There is a huge market of it spread across the northern areas of Haryana, in Himachal, in northern areas of Rajasthan, whole of Punjab. Jalandhar is a very important place where music production takes place, therefore. So there is a market. Delhi becomes a market, in fact. So there is a lot of circulation of the recordings of these performances, both audio as well as visual. So there are therefore intersections through which market intersects with these performances and also emerge as means of production also. But this is not the only thing which becomes important to understand in this process. What is also significant to understand in this process, besides market is how it connects to the shrine spaces which were left behind in Pakistan with newer set of practices which were being reinvented in the post-partition space of India. So the all Sufi said mystic shrines in Pakistan of Sakhi Sarwar, of Baba Farid, of Sufi saints of Lahore, or in fact saints of Baghdad or otherwise, like Abdul Qadir Jilani and others, they are very much vibrantly present in the spaces of Punjab. And the reason for that is performance, circulation. So what becomes as a medium of market is also a medium of circulation of this veneration, circulation of continuous presence of these Sufi saint mystics in the post-partition landscapes. So once again, I know there is a political economy for that, but what does political economy also does culturally, you know, what it brings in, what it also does, how it also helps us space far more vibrantly besides money is also an important aspect to understand. That's what I wanted to point out.
Then I just wanted to ask a couple of questions.
Yes,
one definitely. Is related to, you know, you find that even the smaller shrines or dargahs like Manakpur has also taken a lot of insights, or the you know, the caretakers of the Hyderabad shrines and Ajmer. So this juxtaposition of the dominant dargahs and shrines trying to have a say in a smaller dargahs. So what does that signify? I mean, do you mean to say that people who are revered in these parts of the country, they might also like to see in the making of this dargah? That's one aspect.
Can I respond to this first? And yeah. Can I respond? Okay, because otherwise I'll forget. See, there were existing networks of pilgrimage, pre-partition pilgrimages. And these pilgrimage networks, I mean, this is a long tradition in Punjab to write Vikalat Namas for Ajmer Sharif Shrine. So Punjabis in large numbers, and Punjabis means Hindus and Sikhs, I'm not talking about Muslims, because they were going to Ajmer Sharif, writing Vikalat Namas for Ajmer Sharif. And they used to travel. There are these pilgrim networks which were there pre-partition. We know it. So post-partition, these pilgrimage networks became disrupted. They were disrupted technically. So what therefore is an attempt being performed here is to also reconnect to those other previous pre-partition pilgrimage networks. So the presence of several of these sajadan and nishins, one, help in reinstating certain set of practices. Yes, you're right in sense of certain sense of dominance of a different kind of a narrative. But also what it does is also institutes a kind of a circulation of pilgrimage networks. It brings in reinstated pilgrimage, and they're a very vibrant, interesting pilgrimage network. Actually, each year people travel along from Punjab to these pilgrimage networks, from Ajmer to shrines in Delhi, from Ajmer to Kaliyar to shrines in Delhi, from Panipat. Panipat, you have a very important shrine of Bhuali Kalandar. And from Panipat onwards to some shrines in Punjab, like Meena Peak Shrine near Patiala. So these connected shrines, and predominantly, as you said, they are Chishti, Chishti Sabri and Kadri and Kalandri Shrine. They are not Nashpandi Shrine, they are not Sohrawardi Shrine. They are predominantly more of these other kind of shrines, as I said, predominantly Chishti Shrine, whose network of pilgrimage, the connectivity of these large southern machines performs. The other thing which the presence of sajadan nishin performs is also to legitimize some of the emerging caretakers. So in the case of one shrine, yesterday I was talking about it in Triple IT, in Makhu, he, while getting converted to Islam, also assumes the gaddi of Khanka Chishtiya in Makhu, which is a new shrine which comes up in the 21st century. So there is a sense of legitimization through which also some of these networks get built up. So some new emerging caretakers also seek blessings or connectivity through these bigger shrines to also reinstate their own space, place in the space.
With the advent of Wahhabism and also the Salafis in the, you know, Muslim community, particularly people who have gone to Gulf, and they do not believe in the dargah culture as such. So has that also impacted the number of visitors to these shrines? And are there any exchanges of blows or some conflict of interest that can exist, not just with the Sikhs and the Muslims, but within the Muslim community that you have come across?
Post-partition, obviously none. During the early 20th century, I already said that there were reformist movements from MDRs to among the Anjumans, which were quite very active actually. There was the Ahle Quran Society in Amritsar, which were all propagating against Sufi Saint mystic practices. And though this distinction in the case of Punjab is not the classic distinction that you see in Western UP or otherwise between Deobandis and Barelvis, which kind of becomes very prominent in Sindh area of Pakistan, very where it's quite a violent form of confrontation. You know, they kill each other literally, you know, in Karachi particularly. But that you don't find in Punjab. One of the reason could be because the sheer set of people who visit here are non-Muslims. So what are they addressing to, therefore, is a complicated, complex set of pilgrimage, a complex set of visitation. So the audience, therefore, is very complicated, complex. And the association, the integration of these shrines with local spheres is also very vibrant. So as I was saying yesterday in IIIT, in the case of Bikam Shah's shrine, if I say it in plain Hindi, Bikam Shah's shrine in near Patiala, the interconnectedness of this saint, Bikam Shah, with Guru Gobind Singh. And there's a very interesting story, let me just quickly narrate it. Laltu knows it already. But there's a very interesting story about Guru Gobind Singh fighting against the Mughals in the latter part of the 16th century. And these battles leading to violent killing of the elder sons of Guru Gobind Singh. And thereafter, continuing conflicts. So Guru Gobind Singh had to leave Anandpur, the fort that he had built for himself. And he was literally leaving Punjab in some way. In between, his two of his sons were captured, younger sons. He had four sons. These younger sons were captured by the Nawab of Sirhind. And the order was to bring them alive. Now, on the other hand, while he was passing through the Malwa area, you know, Malwa area is the lower part of Punjab, a larger part of the Indian Punjab. It's a semi-arid. He was passing through that part of Punjab. Sher Mohammad Khan, who was the ruler of the Malerkotla state there, remember, he was aligned to the Mughals otherwise. He shoots a letter to Aurangzeb, who was fighting battles in the Deccan at that point of time. He had fought Malerkotla's Nawab himself had fought several battles against the Sikhs because he was aligned to the Mughals. But in this case, he writes a letter to Aurangzeb saying that you can't kill these two innocent sons of Guru Gobind Singh. Now, popularly, this gesture shown by Sher Mohammad Khan is remembered among the Sikhs very fondly. In fact, it is told that Guru Gobind Singh said that Sikhs will never forget the gesture shown by Sher Mohammad Khan. And this remains on record that during severe partition riots, Malerkotla was never touched. Malerkotla is in the heart of Malwa, remember. Malerkotla was never touched. One of the reasons for it not being touched because it was princely state. So this was a different domain altogether politically. But one of the other reasons because it was not touched was this narrative. The Sikhs would remain kind of show their respect to Malerkotla. So the large number of people who visit Malerkotla are not Muslim. They are all predominantly Sikhs and urban Hindus. So embeddedness of shrines within the space therefore complicates the scenario. And there are several such narratives. I'm just giving you one. I can narrate tens and dozens of other narratives also. Similarly, so intertwined and interspersed and embedded into a local narrative that to fit them into a Wahhabism or Barelvi discourse would not work. Because there is something else which connects them to the spheres, local spheres. So, but then you also have in Punjab a shrine like Shaykh Ahmed Sarhindi's Nashpandi shrine at Sarhind. This was a shrine which was demolished by Banda Singh Bahadur, who went from Nanded to Punjab to take revenge against the killing of the two younger sons. He demolished the shrine. But this was the only shrine which was demolished. Besides, all the mosques of Sarhind, besides the entire fort of Sarhind, it was completely demolished by Banda Bahadur to seek revenge against the killing of the Gobind. But no other shrine was touched because Sheikh Ahmed Sarhindi shrine, Nashbandi as a silsila, was very critical of the Sikhs. It kept writing letters against the Sikhs. So Sikhs had a grudge against the Nashbandi Sufi mystic at that time. So therefore, he got killed. In fact, he wrote a letter celebrating the killing of the two younger sons. So there was a direct grudge, therefore. But in no other case you find any other shrine in Punjab getting touched, getting desecrated, despite the fact that you had partition riots of the most worst kind taking place in Punjab. So that becomes an important practice. Therefore, I'm saying this interspersedness, this embeddedness of shrines into local narratives becomes a very important reason for which other kinds of narratives do not play a very significant role. So, I think I'll stop. Yes, yes. Oh, by the way, on the other side, if you go to Pakistan today, right from in the 21st century, and I drew a list once, I shared it with the scholars there in IIIT yesterday. All major shrines in Pakistan, irrespective of which Sufi order, except for Sohrawardi shrine, the major ones at least, I came across in Multan, they one have not been bombed. Possibly every Chishti shrine in Pakistan, major shrine has been bombed. From Baba Farid to Sheikh Al-Hujwiri, to almost every Kalandari shrine, one of the major ones would be Lal Shehbaz Kalandar shrine in Sahlan. To most important of the Sufi said mystics of the region, like Sakhi Sarwar, whose shrine is in Dera Ghazi Khan, bombed. Every important shrine in Pakistan has been bombed. So that kind of narrative, as you were saying, could work in that part of Punjab. But that would not work on this part of Punjab, because there is a kind of a linear narrative possible there. But that does not disassociate Muslims from going to shrines in Pakistan. Because recently, actually, a German anthropologist wrote a very interesting book on his, and these are anthropological notes on his visitation to some shrines associated with the Kalandaris in Pakistan, about how Urs overnight, how singing and qawwali takes place overnight in Pakistan at several of these Badi Imam and other shrines in Pakistan, from Islamabad and elsewhere until Sindh. So that continues to be a very strong tradition despite what you call Tandemanization of certain kind of discourses in Pakistan. So therefore, as I'm saying, despite these threats, as I gave example of also militant threats in this part of Punjab on the shrine of Manakpur Sharif also, at shrine of Sakhi Sarwar in Hargobindpur also, which is very close to the place where Jarnail Singh Bhindranwala, the village of Jarnail Singh Bhindranwala, very close, two, three villages away from Jarnail Singh Bhindranwala. So Khatri caretaker of the shrine, which was Sonni Khatri, means Hindu Khatri, they were killed. One of the caretakers was killed. So in this part of Punjab also these things happened. But as soon as the militancy went away, shrines became alive once again. Particularly new set of shrines started emerging, which is a very vibrant phenomena. All set up being by non-Muslims, the new ones.
Okay, so if there are no questions, it's time to say thank you so very much, Professor Yogesh, for this very wonderful, engaging and interesting presentation. We really enjoyed it. Thank you. And we look forward to your presence at Lamakaan more and more.